Ruth Bader Ginsburg passed away last Friday, and of course, the fight to replace her is on. Trump and Republicans in the Senate now have the votes to advance a nominee, and all of the reporting has said that Trump is going to choose Amy Coney Barrett to replace Ruth Bader Ginsburg. She is a faithful Catholic. She's a dyed-in-the-wool conservative. I think she's a great choice for Republicans. Now, Democrats, of course, are whining about the fact that Republicans are planning to replace her before the election. And that is because back in 2016, after Antonin Scalia passed away, Republicans held the Senate then. But the presidency, of course, was held by Barack Obama, who nominated Merrick Garland to fill Scalia's seat. And Republicans at the time, led by Mitch McConnell, who was the Senate Majority Leader, said that they were not going to fill the seat in an election year when the presidency and the Senate are held by different parties, because essentially those two parts of the government are at a stalemate. And in order to break that stalemate, they needed to have the 2016 presidential election to see if the people would vote for Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. McConnell actually dubbed this the Biden rule because he was the one who invoked this argument against George H.W. Bush. Now, Democrats are saying that the Republicans are being hypocritical because they didn't want to fill the seat in an election year in 2016. But of course, the key difference is that the presidency and the Senate were held by different parties then, and now they're held by the same party. So it's not really quite as hypocritical as the Democrats claim. At the same time, Democrats in 2016 were complaining that Republicans needed to fill Scalia's seat so that they would have 9 justices on the court, and because it was the obligation and duty of the Senate to fill the vacancy as quickly as possible. Now, of course, in 2020, they are arguing the exact opposite, that they need to wait for the presidential election. So if they are accusing Senate Republicans of being hypocritical, then they are just as hypocritical themselves. And we also have a bunch of people saying that we shouldn't fill the seat because it was Ruth Bader Ginsburg's dying wish that her seat not be filled before a new president was installed. First of all, I was very troubled by RGB's alleged statement that she made on her deathbed, because she specifically says her seat should not be filled until there is a new president, which implies that even if Donald Trump were to win re-election, she would not want her seat filled until another president wins 4 years down the line. And her statement also uses the word installed. In America, presidents are not installed, they are elected. Installed implies some type of coup or revolution, which is a very Marxist thing for her to say. Nonetheless, RGB's dying wish means absolutely nothing in this situation. This is not the Make-A-Wish Foundation, and even in the Make-A-Wish Foundation, the wishes are only granted to children who are still alive. After they die, their wishes kind of float out into the ether. Sad but true. And RBG's dying wish certainly doesn't trump the Constitution, which says that the president is allowed to nominate a Supreme Court justice to fill any vacancy whenever he wants. There's no time restriction on it. And the Senate plays the advise and consent role, and they ultimately get to vote on whether or not to confirm that justice. So the dying wish thing is a red herring. It absolutely means nothing. And the argument is going to be that Trump is heartless because he's not abiding by the dead woman's dying wish. Well, it's ridiculous. It's a ridiculous argument. We shouldn't put any stock in it. Now, the media and Democrats are already going after Amy Coney Barrett. At the time of filming this podcast, she has not actually been nominated yet, but again, all sources are saying that she is going to be Trump's pick, and they're going after her for her Catholic faith. They did this a little bit to Kavanaugh back in 2018 because he was in the Knights of Columbus. Now, Amy Coney Barrett is in a group called People of Prayer, and Reuters and Newsweek both wrote these false articles that claimed that People of Prayer was the inspiration for The Handmaid's Tale. And that's because People of Prayer apparently lines people up with mentors, and the female mentors are called handmaids, and they give advice to people on things like who they should marry, what their finances should look like, how to run their households. It's basically just a mentorship program and a prayer group. I read through this New York Times article that talks about People of Prayer, and I didn't find anything particularly extreme about it, but I guess if you're a leftist that hates religion, then you might. So that strain of anti-Catholicism is already going on to try to sound, make Amy Coney Barrett sound like she's disqualified for the position. Remember in 2017, when she was being considered for a circuit court nomination, Dianne Feinstein famously said, "The dogma lives loudly within you. Watch."
When you read your speeches, the conclusion one draws is that the dogma lives loudly within you. And that's of concern when you come to big issues that large numbers of people have fought for years in this country.
Ron Charles, who was a writer for the Washington Post, tweeted about Amy Coney Barrett that she, quote, "should always remember that a legal career is but a means to an end, and that end is building the kingdom of God." Now, he tweeted this out as if it's something that's supposed to scare us, but that is a very normal statement, of course, from anyone who's a faithful Christian or a faithful Catholic. We believe that life on earth is temporary, and the ultimate goal is to ascend to the kingdom of God in heaven. And, of course, Amy Coney Barrett, who actually adheres to the Catholic faith, would believe that and say something like that. And these people only support Catholics if they don't actually follow the tenets of their religion. So they only support Catholics in name only. For example, Nancy Pelosi or Joe Biden, who are both pro-choice and both support forcing Catholic businesses and charities and organizations to provide birth control for their employees, even though it goes against the tenets of their religion. This has led to an uptick in anti-Catholic hate crimes across the country. We've seen numerous churches desecrated, burned, vandalized over the past several months. It's gotten so bad that Representative Jim Banks has actually sent a letter asking for these hate crimes to be investigated by the DOJ. And the idea, more basically, that people who are religious are incapable of fulfilling their duties of public office is really gross, and it's rooted in this anti-Catholic bigotry that has really existed in America for a long time. And I mean, even recently, back when JFK was running for president, there was this idea that he was going to report directly to the Pope because he was a Catholic and he was going to betray the United States, and that Catholics are incapable of putting country first. And obviously that's not true. There are tons of Catholics who serve in important public positions, who are able to carry out their duties without reporting directly to the Pope. And Bill Barr, Attorney General Bill Barr, I think really has the best explanation of this, because people misunderstand separation of church and state a lot in this country. It was never intended to say that people cannot rule or serve in positions in a way that reflects their religious principles. You can bring the things that you believe or the faith that you believe in to the position that you're serving in. You just can't force anyone else to adhere to a certain religion, be a certain religion. You can't establish a national religion, essentially. The separation of church and state was meant to prevent that, and also to prevent actually the government attacking faith rather than the other way around. So listen to Bill Barr explain this.
In American public discourse, perhaps no concept is more misunderstood than the notion of separation of church and state. Militant secularists have long seized on that slogan as a facile justification for attempting to drive religion from the public square and to exclude religious people from bringing a religious perspective to bear on conversations about the common good. Yet, as events like this one remind us, separation of church and state does not mean, and never did mean, separation of religion and civics. As late as 1952, Justice William O. Douglas would write for a majority of the Supreme Court that we are a religious people whose institutions presuppose a supreme being. Alexis de Tocqueville, the keenest observer of the early American Republic, praised America's separation of church and state while extolling America's union of the spirit of religion and the spirit of liberty as the key to its success.
For some reason, people have this faux sense of neutrality in politics. Like, if you're not religious and you are a congressperson, that you are not imposing your morals on other people, but you're still approaching legislation with a certain ethos, a certain set of morals and principles. And just because they don't come from religion doesn't mean that they aren't guiding what you're doing with your legislation. So I just really dislike this idea that religious people are somehow, anytime that they create a law or believe in something, that they're imposing their religion on other people. Anyone who creates a law is imposing their own set of moral values on other people. And that is how our society gets to a conception of the common good. Otherwise, there would be no, we'd live in an anarchist libertarian hellhole if people weren't approaching legislation or politics with some sense of morality, regardless of where that morality comes from. Anyway, that's a really long way of saying that I think Amy Coney Barrett is a great pick. I'm obviously a little biased because I'm Catholic myself, but I look forward to seeing how this process plays out. You can expect that Democrats are going to basically go full Brett Kavanaugh, and ultimately, I think it's probably going to help Republicans a lot if they go, if the Democrats really go too far with this and put on this spectacle like they did in 2018, right before the president's opportunity to get reelected on November.